My name is Karen, and I am a blue coat scientist at Science North. Today, I have a fun science demonstration to show you on the topic of DNA. Let's go. Everyone has a unique set of instructions inside that makes you, you. This code determines the color of your hair, the color of your skin, and even if you can cross your eyes or not. Okay, so most of us know that it's DNA, but DNA actually stands for deoxyribonucleic acid. It is a molecule with a bunch of atoms stuck together to form a curved ladder, or called a double helix. Now, DNA is the blueprint of all living things, but how does it actually work? Well, to understand how it works, we first have to look at amino acids. Amino acids are very important since they are the building blocks of life. There's approximately 20 different kinds, and you can think of them as Legos. Some are different colors, and some can be put together to make almost anything. When amino acids come together, they make protein, which this turns into cells. Then the cells turn into tissues, then to organ, then finally, you get a living organism like a cat or a tree or a dinosaur. So how do amino acids and protein tie into all this? Well, one of the main functions of DNA is to tell amino acids how to make or form the perfect protein. The protein is then sent out to various functions. Let's take a look at a DNA strand once again. The sides of the ladders are made of sugars, and the insides are made of bases. There are four different bases: A, adenine; T, thymine; G, guanine; and C, cytosine. Now, all these bases are very picky with who they get along. So A is only friends with T, and G is only friends with C. They will not hang out with anyone else, and the pair fits together like pieces of a puzzle. Now, your body reads the DNA code like a sentence in a book. In the same way that you would write 100 different words using only 26 letters of the alphabet, there are endless DNA code sentences using those four bases and pair combos. Now, each word has about three letters, and it's like a recipe to read or make amino acids. Now, DNA strands are very long and remain coiled up in the nucleus of a cell. The amino acids, however, live outside the nucleus. In order for the amino acid to get to the DNA to make protein, the DNA will make a copy of a section, which we call it RNA. Because it is a smaller section, the RNA can fit through the pores and get out of the nucleus. The amino acid then is used to make protein. So, let's recap. DNA makes a copy of itself called RNA. The RNA is used to make amino acids. Amino acids then comes together to make proteins. Proteins makes cells. Cells makes up tissues. Tissues makes up all living things. Now, I'm going to show you how you can make your own DNA strand using things around the house. So, you will need 1 tablespoon of rubbing alcohol, 3 clear cups or small bowls, 1/3 cup of water, 2 teaspoons of dish soap, 1/2 teaspoon of salt, 1 strawberry, a small wire strainer or paper towel or coffee filter, toothpick, and fork. First, we have to make the extraction mixture. Place the bottle of rubbing alcohol in the freezer. Don't worry, it will not freeze solid, but we have to have the mixture very cold. Measure 1/3 cup of water and pour it into the cup or the bowl. Add 2 teaspoons of dish soap to the water. Stir in 1/2 teaspoon of salt and mix it all together until the salt dissolves. Careful not to create too many bubbles. Next, we will prep the strawberry. Place 1 strawberry in the other cup or bowl. To make things easier, you can put the strawberry in the microwave for a few seconds until it is mushy. Once the strawberry is out of the microwave, use the fork to smoosh the strawberry. You can definitely use your hands too. pour the extraction mixture into the cup or bowl that has the strawberry. Mix it all together, but again, don't create too many bubbles. Now it's time to extract the DNA. Place the small strainer or paper towel or coffee filter on top of the last cup or bowl. Now, this last cup or bowl should be clean in order to see all the DNA. Pour the strawberry mixture into the strainer. You want to get as much of the liquid in the cup, but the least amount of strawberry pieces. Now take the rubbing alcohol out of the freezer and pour 1 tablespoon into the strawberry mixture. Make sure you pour it very slowly so that the ice-cold rubbing alcohol sits on top of the strawberry mixture. Now let it sit for a few minutes. As time goes by, you will see the DNA strands start floating to the top. With a toothpick, try to pick the small strands of DNA. Amazing, right? Okay, here's how it works. In order to extract the DNA, each ingredient plays a very important role. The reason we use soap is to help dissolve the cell membrane. The salt is used to break down the protein chain that holds the nucleic acids together. This releases the DNA strands. And finally, the ice-cold rubbing alcohol doesn't dissolve DNA. It helps it hold together. The long, thick fibers being pulled out of the extraction mixture are actually real DNA strands of a strawberry. All other fruits that are soft can be easily mashed, but strawberries are the best choice for this activity because of 2 reasons. First, the seeds of the strawberries are located on the outside of the fruit, which makes it easier to crack and release the DNA. And second, the strawberries are octoploid, which means that they have 8 copies of each DNA chromosome. Humans have only 2 sets of chromosomes, which is why we are called diploid. So if DNA is replicated again and again, why is it that people or even siblings have different hair colors or eye colors? Well, variations in DNA are responsible for this. These variations will change how a living thing looks and develops. A set of DNA instructions is called a genome. Now the genome, there are trillions of DNA letters that are divided into something called chromosomes. Now every human has 46 chromosomes, 23 from your dad and 23 from your mom. There is also a tiny circle of DNA that is passed down from every mother to their children. That exists only in the mitochondria of the cells. If you know where to look, you can trace a person's family tree on their mother's sides as far back as you can. DNA is formed in sequence called genes. No, not the genes that you wear. Now, genes should be in a specific order, but sometimes the letter will not be in the place that they're supposed to be. There's nothing wrong with that. It's just, it's a variant in the genes. So it just means that it can change the difference between the brown hair or maybe the blonde hair, maybe the changes between tall and short, or the changes between blue eyes and green eyes. These variants are what makes everyone unique. So when you get the chromosomes from your dad and your mom, you only get half of their genes, which they also have 46 chromosomes. This is why siblings might look different or maybe almost the same. Some humans will share the same genes. Actually, all humans are 99.9% alike. So only 0.1% makes us all different. So we're way more similar than we are different. What makes us different is the different variations and combinations of our genes. When it comes to genes and genetic traits, you have to keep in mind that there are so many combinations that sometimes people are able to do things that others can't, even if they are related. These genetic traits can be similar between people, while it can be very different between others. Now let's take a look at some blue coats with these genetic traits. Detached or attached earlobes. Being able to roll your tongue. being able to wiggle your ears. Having dimples. A cleft chin. A widow's peak. Freckles. Curly hair or straight hair. Bitter taste. Some like bitter, some don't. Now, there are no right or wrong traits. It just goes to show how many combinations humans have. All the traits that you've seen are based on genetics, but the environment, development, and personality can have a major factor. Something that doesn't change based on environment or personality are fingerprints. Now, fingerprints first form before we're even born. Their shape and pattern depends partly on genetics and partly on random events that might happen in the womb during development. This means that no two fingerprints are alike, even when it comes to identical twins. Although they might have the same DNA, their hormone levels, length of umbilical cord, and food consumption differ. These can cause different patterns in their fingerprints to form. Now, take a look at your hands. Can you tell if all your fingerprints are the same? No. Well, that's exactly what we're going to do today. First, it's important to know that fingerprints are divided into three categories based on their patterns. We have loops, whorls, and arches. 65% of the population have loop pattern fingerprints, while 30 to 35% have whorls, and about 5% have arches. Today, we're going to blow up our prints and examine their patterns and determine what kind of prints we each have. For this activity, you will need a carbon tip pencil, or ink pad, or markers, or food coloring, a blank white piece of paper, and your fingers. Here are your instructions. Start by tracing both of your hands onto your sheet of paper and label them left and right. Now with your thumb on your right hand, color just the pad of your finger. Press your finger onto the outline that matches. Continue these steps until all of your fingers have been printed and the pattern appears on your outline. Now it's time to be a detective and explore what kind of fingerprint patterns you have. You can also get some of your family members to participate in this experiment. This will determine if they have similar fingerprint patterns. Throughout history, genetics has been very important to understand humans as well as all living things on our planet. From a plant to a hummingbird to a blue whale to a giraffe to a human, all depend on these special instructions that make up all living organisms. We even share DNA with other living organisms. Humans share 98.7% of their DNA with chimpanzees. But did you know that we also share 85% of our DNA with a mouse, 40% with a fruit fly, and 41% with bananas? Oh, hi, cousin. Now, lastly, the question of the day is, if you could stretch DNA from one single cell nucleus, how long would it be? 2 millimeters? 2 centimeters? 2 meters? Or 2 kilometers? Hashtag your answer to #scienceathome. Thank you so much for joining me at home today. I had a great time teaching you about DNA. Have a great day.